Hello, by Sir Walter Jones Show. I'm he. It is Sunday, the weekend edition, baby. At the time this recording is 9:35 in the p.m. I think it's March the 19th. I think it is. Tomorrow is the first day of spring for 2017. We're so excited, thus of us. Who live in Chicago, we are just elated. We're just so excited that the Lord has blessed us to go through another winter without major snow. We hardly had any. The month of February, we broke a lot of records, right? Not only have we not had any major snow, we had degrees in the upper 60s and 70s and stuff like that. Boy, the Lord is soon to come. Today we are looking into a book that came to me by a friend by the name of Joyce A. Graham. This book here, it is Book of the Month. Let me know if y'all got books that you want me to review. I will read them and I will review them. I'm excited to do this starting 2017. I said that we were going to build some generational wealth and we were going to help those of you who have products for sale. For instance, yesterday we talked about Millie's Sweet and Tasty. Oh, how beautiful and glorious the Lord is. The anointed hands of this wonderful couple. And so I want you guys to go ahead and try and support my friends, Craig and Antoinette Brown. Millie's Sweet and Tasty. Oh, you gotta taste it. Well, what a great commercial list I am. Praise the Lord, Ernest Langston. It's so great to see you. Millie's BBQSquare.com. Millie's BBQSauce.com. Where do I get square from? I don't know what's wrong with my eyes. All right, let's get this ball a crack-a-lack, and y'all go ahead and hit the share button. I want to talk about this book. This book right here blessed me. Barbara Taylor, you here? Keisha Smith, bless you. How you doing? So good to see you. Lisa Ivy, blessings. Carolyn Anderson, if y'all still here, blessings. Hit the like button if you're still here. If I'm calling your name, hit the like button. We need to know that you're here. Carolyn Anderson, bless you. Deatrice Carter, blessings to you. Art Lewis, blessings to you. Jeanette Halton, blessings. Hit the like button. My dear friend, Kista Lynn Patterson, blessings to you. If you're here, hit the like button. Hey, Barbara Taylor, the Lord has blessed this woman of God here with the wisdom to know how to tell Walter when he right and when he wrong. Barbara A. Taylor, God has sent her in my life. Okay, this book here, this is Succession, Mentoring the Next Generation. I'm going to tell y'all this. Bless you, Lisa. I'm going to tell y'all this. Marty, I'm going to tell y'all this. If you do not have this book, then you ain't got no books. This book right here, Barbara said, be good, is a blessing. I think every pastor, every apostle, every bishop, okay, every administrative assistant need to have this. Every CEO need to have this book. Every father need to have this book, okay? I don't care if you're an evangelist, a prophet, a teacher. You need to have this book because everybody needs to follow behind you. I think the great Miles Monroe talked about the cemetery where there's so many wealth of people in the cemetery. You're supposed to die empty, but many of us die with so much that we should have left to mankind. This book right here will walk you through the process. It is short. I read it within an hour, believe it or not. That's how good it is, and that's how short it is. It's to the point. Ain't but 130-something pages, 140-something pages, okay? And I want you to have this book. You gotta have it. So I need her to put the information down there. Again, let me show you what it looks like. All right, from this vantage point. All right, that's the book we're getting ready to talk about. Succession, Mentoring the Next Generation, Joyce A. Graham. Okay? All right. Okay. Let's talk about this. Who's the author again? Joyce A. Graham. Go on Amazon.com. Barbara, you got to have this book. Okay, Angela, my copy will arrive next week. Praise God. Okay, she just put the information right there. I'm getting ready to talk about this. Joyce A. Graham, each predecessor leaves behind a labor of love, and each successor builds upon that labor of love, bringing a uniqueness that will enhance the work of their predecessor while making it their own. All right, this is what she's saying, the about page here on the back. I'm trying to see, did she put something here, well, about herself, okay? I mean, she cited the book properly. I mean, this book took some time. She's got a glossary in here for those of you who don't need to. Oh, you gonna purchase it, Barbara? Praise God. Come on, y'all. Y'all buy this book. This is a manual. This is not just a book. This is a manual for leadership. All right. Let me go to the beginning of this page here. All right. Successions. She even quoted Dr. Miles Monroe. All right. I only wrote about my personal experience regarding succession and mentoring. She just wrote about herself. The greatest obligation of a true leader is to transfer a deposit into the next generation. We keep doing this, we keep talking about this generational wealth. It's not about you. It's not about your wealth. Stop taking your money and worrying about what you're going to spend it on tomorrow. No, you need to be worried about what your children going to do with your money. You need to be worried about what your grandchildren, your children's children going to do about your money. You see, generation, a rich, a wealthy man, he thinks about the next generation. He don't think about next week. All right. So as you go from day to day and you are instructing the people of God, you're giving them insights and what have you, I don't care what you do in life, you should be thinking about the people who are watching you. And I'm going to talk about some of my experiences here, too. So it says the worst mistake a leader can make is to mentor no one. Choose no successor and leave no legacy. Woo! Lord have mercy. That's Dr. Miles Monroe. Y'all know that's a great man of God. God took him, and we'll see him again. It's in loving memory of her parents, Thomas S. Johnson and Rosa L. Johnson, and her brother, Willie L. Johnson. All right. Now, this table of contents, it's kind of backwards here, but I'm going to talk about the first two chapters, all right, at length, and then I'll kind of just cite the succession examples, all right? I made some highlights here. Each predecessor leaves behind a labor of love. I read that already, but let me go to the introduction. She says, when I first shared the book, the idea that is for the book, I was asked if I was going to include a chapter on secular succession. And she said, I considered it, but then decided against it. One of the main reasons why I decided against it is because the corporate world, understand this, the corporate world, y'all work in that world, appears to already have a grasp on the concept of succession. I worked in the corporate world, corporate America, and my boss was preparing somebody to take over that corporation. I saw it all the time, whether it was their children or whether it was someone that they trusted in. They realized that a position can become vacant at any given moment, so they prepare for such contingencies. That's the way it is. Great way to kick this off, okay? She says, someone once said that every leader is an interim leader. Pastor Ken Williams is here. Blessings to you. My dear sister Marie Johnson is here, okay? Aura is here. Please get this book. I'm telling you, this is going to bless you. And I haven't even met the author yet. I don't even really know the author. I mean, I'm going to travel to St. Louis on business, but I'm going to sit with her and her husband and just sit in their presence. I'm telling you, this is good stuff. Someone said that every leader is an interim leader. Churches will eventually lose their ministers, pastors, bishops. Y'all gonna die one day. You bishops out there, you pastors, you apostles, y'all gonna be dead one day. All right? I just need you to know that. Y'all leaving here. And spiritual leaders, retirement, relocation, termination, promotion, next phase of ministry, a new assignment, protracted illness, or some other unforeseen emergency. Y'all getting up out of here, all right? And you don't have to be dead for someone to come behind you, and we're going to give some examples here. I see, again, I mentioned Pastor Karen Williams. I don't know if she's still here, but her mama is yet alive, kicking and going everywhere, flying around the country and doing whatever she need to do, but she gave the church over to her daughter, and her daughter is kicking. I'm saying, you see what I'm saying? While she was yet alive, she's like, you know what? I got other things to do, and I want to see my children flourish. They saw my works, so why not? Now I can see their works. All right. So she talked about her personal experience, which blessed me here. She said, I learned about the concept of succession very early in my walk with the Lord. Although my first succession experience was extremely painful, it taught me an invaluable lesson that would drive my ability to identify with successors and predecessors for the rest of my life. I highlighted this part because it says here, it was right then and there that I realized that I had been used to phase her out. See, she was a typist. She did clerical work for her pastor, the author, who's here right now. Say amen to Joyce A. Graham. She's right here now. she did clerical work for a pastor some time ago. But the pastor already had someone doing clerical work, doing the typing the letters, okay, correspondence and what have you. But the pastor did not tell Graham, okay, that she didn't tell the old girl, okay, that there's a new girl on the block. So Graham was started doing the work and then started bragging in a sense about, boy, the pastor's really using my gift. And she talking to the girl who the pastor stopped calling to do the typing for. And she realized, uh-oh. Okay? She says here, it was right then and there I realized that I had been used to phase this girl out. Used. She says, I found out later that the pastor considered her work inadequate when compared to mine, but instead of confronting her directly, he simply replaced her with me. I can't tell you how many times I've seen this happen among pastors. They're just like, okay, you next in line. You got the job. That happened to me. I didn't know what to do when a person who actually hadn't had the job yet, they were next in line to fill that spot because they was the assistant for many years. I come from off the street, okay, and start doing my work. I wasn't trying to prove nothing. I just was doing the work the Lord has given me to do. The person was in line already to do the work. And then before you know it, the pastor said, you now the man. I'm like, who the man? You the man. And didn't tell the other person. And I'm like, well, this person is in line. They're like, I'm the pastor. You the man. So now I got to work with this person, okay, who got kind of kicked to the curb. You know what I'm saying? And I'm saying, why do this happen? Why do pastors do that? All right? It's just not right. So what happens is sometimes pastors will put people over something, and then they go home and eat and go travel, what have you. But we got to work with each other in ministry. All right, sometimes they just don't think. Let's pray for the wisdom of these pastors. Okay, she's too young and far too inexperienced to address an issue like that with my pastor or question his method of transitioning the people who work for him. I said, she says, I was too young. I was too inexperienced. I can't correct my pastor. I mean, how do I do that to my pastor? You're wrong. How do I know it's not from the Lord? I just don't know. Art said that's a moral killer. Barbara says that they do it because they can. Yep. Great answer. You're right. I continued working for him, fully aware that the young lady who previously worked for him had been hurt and devastated in the process. Many of these leaders, they hurt people. They hurt them, and then they go on to another ministry, or they don't go to another ministry. They stay in the streets. They stay home. They don't fellowship with nobody anymore, because we keep hearing about church hurt. And church, the worst church hurt is the one that comes from your own shepherd. Man, I'm telling y'all, you need to get this book. It's going to bless you. I'm going to keep saying that. Hit the share button. So she said, here's why I wrote the book. The idea for this book was birthed from my own personal concern and, to much a greater extent, my frustrations. Both in, number one, leadership's inability to refusal to embrace the concept of succession and mentoring. Please, leaders, you got to be mentoring somebody. You ain't going to live forever. All right, that's number one. Number two, potential young leaders clamoring for a title or a position with no regard for the real work. All right, everybody, all these musicians friends I have who want to make $600-$700 for an hour and a half service and ain't did the work that I did. Okay, ain't went through the trenches like I did. Don't even know how to play Amazing Grace on the keyboard, and you're going to walk in there demanding all this money. I'm sorry. Only I can demand $1,000 of service. You can't. You still got Similac coming out your ears, right? I've been in the trenches for 37 years. I can ask for whatever I want to ask, and I gets it. You see, because they know if this man is in service, the Spirit of the Lord is going to come within 5 minutes. Because this man knows how to shift with the atmosphere. Not you. You still a little boy trying to suck on your thumb, talking about some, what that song? What key that? How you play that? Amazing. Great. What that is? Now, please, stop. Pay you nothing. I'm going to pay you respect. That's all I'm going to pay you. Okay? And she says, I have watched a bright, ambitious, gifted youth in ministry struggled while older leaders purposely and intentionally withheld their support because they felt threatened and intimidated. Poor Tink Tink. Okay? Sadly, most of these youths lost their enthusiasm, slowly faded into the background, or were gradually eclipsed by the people who were responsible for mentoring them. You were responsible. Lord have mercy. Y'all got to get this book, Succession. Mm-hmm. Mentoring the Next Generation by Joyce A. Graham. My favorite author this month, y'all, is that woman of God. Mm-mm-mm. So we're going to chapter one. Watch this. Defining the succession process. Barbara A. Taylor, help me out with this, okay? I know you got some comments here that's going to bless us, all right? So let's talk about chapter one and chapter two, shall we? All right? Defining. How do we define succession? The process of it, all right? That's because you are a minister. Oh, but Rochelle Corbin, you better stop with my offering plate so I can take out of it and give it to you, okay? Chapter one, defining the succession process. Here it is. For the purpose of this book, I define succession as the order in which or the condition under which a position, a title, or a ministry is transferred from one leader to another. It has been said that the greatest measure of the true success of a leader is in knowing when it's time to relinquish his current position and in his ability to identify, mentor, and release his successor. You got to know when it's time to sit down. You got to know when it's time to say, okay, it is time. Remember the old show, the karate show called, what is it called? Karate Man or Karate something? Where he was, Art, are you here? My nerd, Art, help me out, okay? David Carradine, you remember that show in the 70s? David Carradine? And he called him Grasshopper, okay? And, you know, the master was training that little boy, all right? Paint the fence, okay? I know I got two movies mixed up, but paint the fence, okay? And do all these little things, all right? And so he had him going through these extraneous exercises because he was preparing him. And then one day, you know, y'all know the knock the thing off of my shoulder. Y'all know that old thing, you know, okay? He realized, okay, you ain't ready yet. Every day, you ain't ready. And then he says, all right, you're ready, Grasshopper. I think every Kung Fu. Thank you, Rochelle. You got to know when it's time. And see, there's Kung Fu and there's Karate Kid, Joyce, okay? Many have left secular jobs to devote their efforts to full-time ministry. And the funds or salary generated from ministry has been their main source of income. Many of your leaders come off that secular job, and the church is supporting their habits of staying alive. Okay. Countless others enjoy the power and the privilege and the prestige attached to ministerial positions. Some leaders simply cannot envision themselves doing anything other than what they've done for the greater portion of their lives. It's hard for some of these leaders to say, just sit down and move and have someone to take their position. That's why many pastors die without building up and preparing a successor, and the church busts up. We are seeing that right now in a few of our cities. I'm looking at it right now. Pastors are living, thinking that they are going to live forever, and then they get sick. And so now they think that God is going to heal them, and he can if he chooses to. But then they get sicker and sicker and sicker, but they keep praying that God is going to heal them. Meanwhile, they're not thinking about putting nobody in up there. Why? Because I built this church. I built this church, and I've been the CEO of this ministry for 40 years, okay? 50 years, 60 years. So how difficult is it? And these kind of pastors got their hands in every aspect of that ministry. They got their hands in the usher department. They got their hands on the deacon board. They got their hands in the music ministry. Everything. They can't do nothing. They don't trust the ones who are over these departments that much. So they got to be micromanaged, okay? So these men get sick. They get sick, all right? And then what happens? These men die. Now the church... You got like this political party, this political situation we have now with the Republicans and the Democrats. Like, we're like, okay, who gonna run this country? Yeah, and believe it or not, that happened in the Church of God in Christ with Bishop C.H. Mason, a great man, but there was no established successor in the Church of God in Christ. So the government had to step in and say, y'all need to come together in a convention to set up a constitution. Well, many of you pastors out there, I don't care how young you are. I don't care if you're 35. You need to be preparing somebody because you may not live that long. You just don't know how God is going to affect that ministry or what he will allow. Barbara says, honestly, good and wise succession planning is supposed to begin from the beginning. I knew Barbara Taylor was going to be here. When a leader starts, just like the presidency, Barbara Taylor, what I tell you about that woman, okay? Says frequently, most leaders simply do not understand the biblically based concept of succession. They don't understand. She says, however, one of the main reasons that the majority of today's leaders are resistant to the concept of succession is because they erroneously believe that it should only occur as a result of their own demise. You see what I'm saying? We right here, Joyce, we right here. While it is true that a succession might be invoked as a result of calamity, such as death or illness, termination or other unforeseen maladies, there are other valid considerations for vacating a position, such as retirement. And I think she put a wonderful story here in Numbers chapter 8, 19, talking about the Levites. God had the Levites to work in the church, in the temple, that is. It wasn't really a church, per se, okay? They worked in the temple. Them and the priests. They had duties, okay? The tithes went to them. They had no inheritance. They could not own any land. God said, you're working in the temple, I'm going to pay you back. So the people will pay a tithe, and it will feed you and your families, all right? But he did not treat them like Hebrew slaves, because when they turned 50, God kind of retired them from that position. He didn't retire them from doing nothing, sitting on the do-nothings. They just was moved to a position that was less strenuous. They're 50. God honored that. Like some jobs honor people who, after a certain age, okay, especially if they get sick or something happened, they get carpal tunnel. So what happens is the doctor says, okay, you don't have to leave that job, but your job cannot have you picking up boxes no more, right? Because there's something going on with you physically, so they put them on light duty. Some cops are put on desk duty. You see what I'm saying? That's what God did with the Levites. He put them on desk duty. Go to Numbers 8 and 19, all right? So retirement. Man, I'm telling y'all, this book right here is going to bless you. Pursuit of the next phase of ministry. Frequently, God will summon leaders to the next phase of their ministry or to position that requires a greater level of responsibility. In these instances, God might require that leaders relinquish their current position in order to serve in the new one. That seat don't belong to you forever. You don't own that seat. God lets you sit there. It's not your right. It's a privilege to serve there. And then God says, okay, it's time for you to move to the seat over there, because that brother right there who's been looking at you, paying attention to you, following you everywhere you need to go, carrying your briefcase, that's the one I'm preparing to sit in this seat here. Move, boy, move. So the next one is relocation. Sometimes you just got to relocate. When God directs leaders to serve in another capacity, he may also require that they relocate to a different geographical area. That's just the way it is. If your leader get up and say, I got to go, God got me on a journey, you just say, bye-bye, love, bye-bye, loneliness, okay? Hey, Danny, blessings to you. Reasons for this may be to expand the leader's vision, to advance and enhance the leader's ministry, or to minister to an entirely different body of believers. Don't be trying to make say, you can't go nowhere, pastor, evangelist, you just can't. Yes, I can, because I did all I can for you. Now, this sister here is going to take you further. Mm-hmm. You see, Moses, I'm ahead of myself. See, Moses could only go so far. Lord have mercy. All right, whatever the reason I have identified, 10 key elements for a successful, effective succession. All right, 10 keys here. All right, praying, number one, pray before, during, and after each step of your process. Man should always pray and not faint. Number two, identifying the position and the need for succession. What's your position? Have you properly identified it? Number three, identifying the human entity responsible for approval of the succession. Ultimately, final approval from who? From the Lord. Number four, identifying who? The successor. Number five, that was number four. This is number five. Detachment process of the predecessor. Did y'all understand that one? She will go into detail later on. Number six, execution of the mentoring phase of the succession process. How do you even execute it? Number seven, timing of the departure of the predecessor. Number eight, ensuring the integrity of the succession process. Number nine, installing the successor. And then number 10, anticipating or addressing contingencies along this continuum. Because each succession is unique. Don't say because the Pehokee Church of God of the Living Christ Baptist International did it this way that Faith Temple gonna do it the same way. Not so. Every house don't operate the same way. You can't tell me how to raise my kids. My kids know my leading and ruling differently than yours, okay? You let your kids stay out at after midnight. Not in my house. Oh, no. Before the street lights came on, my babies had to be in the house. Yours stayed out after the street lights. That's how you ran your house, okay? But I'm sorry. Your kids in jail. Okay. Because each succession is unique, the sequence of these 10 key elements, it may vary. However, omitting even one of these key elements might very well impede the succession process and may even result in an unsuccessful succession. That's chapter 1, y'all. I'm about to go to chapter 2 and about to bless you, okay? Chapter 1, again, she was talking about how do you define the whole succession process. How do you take a person that's sitting here and remove them, or they remove themselves, or they prepare the person to come? Okay, how do you do that? That's what chapter 1 is all about. Y'all got to get this book, Succession by Joyce A. Graham. The link is above, y'all. All right, this is chapter 2. Are you ready for this? Defining the mentoring process. You see, why do we forget about the mentoring part? Are you a mentor? Who have you mentored lately? A show of hands. Who have you mentored lately? Right? Because if you haven't mentored anybody in the last 30 days, something wrong with your life. Get your life right. Okay? Somebody is watching your every move. And I ain't even just talking about your cheering or your spouse. Sometimes spouses are mentoring each other. I ain't talking about them. I'm talking about strangers. I'm talking about people who are on your job, okay? I'm talking about people who are in your ministry. They're watching you. They're checking you out. And don't be hiding yourself, you know? I'm tired of these musicians hiding their chords as if they built these chords. They made these chords. They created these chords. And so some young man come up and say, can you teach me how to play them chords? Right? No, I ain't got time. Really? You ain't got time. Somebody's set your little bald-headed butt down and showed you chords. Whether you paid for it at a school or whether you was sitting next to me and I showed it to you 15 years ago, you got time. Because you ain't going to be sitting on that organ forever. Somebody got to take the minstrel's place. The Levites, after 50 years, they had to retire. Y'all calling yourselves Levites in the church now, you're going to have to give it up. See, if I call myself a Levite, I'll be 51 in just a few, all right? So really, I supposed to have just retired last year. Why am I sitting on somebody's piano organ at the church? Because I want to, all right? Not because I have to. So here's how we define the mentoring process. Get the book, y'all. Get the book. Mentoring is one of the most critical components of the succession process. It is the catalyst through which God prepares the next generation of leaders to continue his plan and for his people. Dr. Miles Monroe describes mentoring as a commitment to develop and train successors through the impartation of knowledge, the sharing of experience, and the transferring of authority. All throughout the Bible, we have examples of leaders who were mentored by great predecessors, and conversely, examples of leaders who were not mentored and were not adequate prepared to carry on the work. I highlighted here page 35. What does it mean to mentor someone? And she gives a person by the name of Pat Enos. I'm going to have to research this Pat Enos because I was blessed by it. She says, I love how Pat Enos describes, and I'm assuming, see, Pat sometimes could be a unisexual name, so I don't know if this Pat is this female, Joyce? Is Pat a female? Because I know Pat is a unisexual name sometimes. At least back in the day, in my day it was. All right? Okay. I love how Pat Enos, she says, yes, thank God, describes the mentoring process of a series of 5 distinct seasons in her article. And this article is called A Season of Mentoring. All right? A Season of Mentoring. What are you saying, Rochelle? Even though the Levites retired, they had to help the younger Levites. There it is. So that they would not profane the things of the temple. Rochelle, it's like you're reading this book. It's like you're reading this book. Because that's exactly what she said in this book. Now, let me tell you something. I'm going to tell y'all something. If I was talking about sex, scandals, if somebody said something that was so outlandish, if I was doing a show about something funny and hilarious, we'd have 80 people watching this show right now. All right? But because I'm talking about something that's dealing with succession, that's dealing with possibly you need to make a move or your pastor or someone above you, they ain't watching. Mm-hmm. If I was going to talk about finances and how to make some money, it'd be 1,000 people on this thing right now. Mm-hmm. I'm trying to tell y'all, all right? But if I was talking about, okay, y'all need some life insurance, all y'all would leave right now. Because you don't want to hear about the stuff that you need. See, that's what we do. That's what's wrong with my people. We like to hear about the rough. They said, tell us a smooth saying, prophets. Give us stuff about how much money I'm going to make. Am I going to get that house or that car? Tell me about how God's going to bless. Don't tell me about the other stuff that I don't want to hear about. Why do we do that? I'm trying to tell you all this. That's the way it is. But I'm going to share this video. I'm going to pay for some Facebook advertising. I need the people to understand that this is important. This is what's going to affect you for the rest of your life. And the people, they don't want to hear. They don't want to hear. That's my peach. That's my peach. Okay? Joyce, what are you saying? Who said it first? That is the problem. Leaders are resistant to the concept of succession. That's why the leaders ain't tuning in right now. They don't want to hear about this. No, I'm going to keep my church till I'm 90, then retire and give it to my son. Oh, really? Did God said he was going to let you live for 90 more? Mm-mm. They do not want to make room for the emerging generation. Mm-mm-mm. Thanks, my sister, for writing the book. Amen. Okay, so this person here, Pat Enos, have an article called A Season of Mentoring, all right? And the season of contact, this first one here is the season of contact. This is the season early in the mentoring relationship where the mentor and the mentoree are identified. Have you identified the person who's getting ready to, you, the predecessors out there, have you identified the succession? Who is this person watching you, checking you out? At my church, I'm on the organ, and DJ, the young man, he's about 14 years old. He looks over at my fingers. He's on the piano, sometimes he's on the organ, no matter whichever he's on. He looks over there at me play, and he watches, and then he emulates me. And I'm careful what I play in church. Are y'all understanding what I'm saying here? Once I have come in contact and I have identified who's going to take my place at that church, then, now that I know that it's him, I watch how I play. I make sure I don't put nothing in there that just don't belong to the service. I make sure that when the spirit shifts, I shift with it. And sometimes I force the shift because the people are just sitting on God. And so I take the shift and I make sure he watches this stuff. And then after service, he said, can you show me those rhymes? In this? I said, yes, I sure can. You best believe I'm going to show you because you about to take my gig. You about to take my job, and I'm excited about it. Ain't no jealousy here. Oh, no to the no, no, no. Okay? All right. So make that contact. Find out who it is and lock your eyes on them because y'all getting ready to tap dance. It may take years, but y'all getting ready to go to the ball. All right? Number two, the season of coaching. This is why I'm talking about it right here. This is the coaching season, see? This is the season where the mentors take the mentoree under their wing and share their life experiences. You see, I make sure that I take DJ's little head, he got a little head, and I make sure I hold it like this. Sometimes I hold his head like that. You know why I hold his head like that? Because I don't want his head to swell when people are honoring him and say, "Ooh, that little boy on that piano, that organ, that DJ, oh, he's the greatest thing." Just go off and say, no. Calm that down. I want him to be humble like me. I don't want him to go through the trenches like I did. He gonna go through some trenches, but I don't want him to go through the same trenches that I went. I had wine, women, and song. I mean, I got messed up. I was in places I didn't belong. I was King David. I went through that stuff. Why? Because I took myself through that. God didn't force me through that. I did that. And I'm gonna protect DJ. I'm gonna make sure he don't go through that. So I hold his head. I hold his head and continue to whisper things in him to empower him, but to humble him. Because he ain't going to be laying with Bathsheba like I did. Ain't going to happen. I went through hell. Took myself through it. He ain't going through that. Now he going to go through some fights. But oh boy, the Lord has given me the anointing to help these young men. No, you ain't going to that. No, you can't go to that party. No, you can't go to that midnight musical. You can't go. And his mama gave me the thumbs up, say, keep doing that. I said, Mama, can I? And she said, go ahead, do it. Because I need him to be safe, you know, even from these homosexuals who still today try to hit on me because they just don't understand. There's 100% pure man right here, okay? Now, don't get it twisted, because I told you I love you. Don't think it's that kind of love, all right? And so these guys are coming. They're going to come and want to find out who he is, what he, these little pedophiles. Oh, no, I hold his head like that. Said, no, you can't go into those arenas. No. Like that movie, Get Out. No. Okay? A season of coaching. My God today. Rochelle, what you saying? This is a great teaching for the remnant that God is raising up. Hallelujah. Yes. This is a season where the mentors take the mentoring under their wing and share their life experience. The mentor also monitors the service of the mentoree. All right, my eyes. Offering constructive criticism and even rebuke if needed. Why y'all afraid to rebuke somebody? Scriptures tell you, you have the right. As long as you're spiritual, you can rebuke, reprove, build up, chastise. 1 Timothy. Was it 1 Timothy? Oh, she going to talk about it here. Okay. 2 Timothy 3:16. Come on now. Tell them you're wrong. My best friends, they tell me, Walter, you were wrong. You were wrong. And that's why they're my best friends still to this day after all these years, because they tell me, dude, you was out of order. You was wrong. And I say, you know what? Thank you. Rebuke them when they're wrong, because they're getting ready to take your seat. And your seat is a seat of honor. And you've built this corporation, this ministry up with the leadership of the Lord. Somebody, whoever's going to fill that seat, got to walk in the same anointing, man. Stop playing with me. So rebuke if needed. All done in the spirit of love. The mentoree is being closely monitored during this time while the mentor is being closely observed. It is extremely important that the mentor models godly behavior and exemplifies the mind of Christ. There won't be no cute little nasty jokes going across with me and DJ. Oh, no. All of my words will be laced with joy and love and peace and holiness and hard work and all that other stuff. You best believe that. The first one is the season of contact. Then comes the season of coaching. And now the season of counseling. Woo! So the coaching, that's something that I'll take his hands and put in his hands on these chords, okay? Here's how you play this hymn, all right? And then if you're in this key, this is what you do. And when the service shifts, here's what you do. He watches me and I'm coaching him. Now comes the season of counseling. Oh, man. Right here it says, the mentor must have a discerning spirit during his time. You better be tapped into the anointing. To baby, you can't counsel everybody, and everybody can't counsel you. Can't do it. Observing the strengths and weaknesses of the mentoree. Be checking that person out. try to figure out what's making them tick and what makes them tick off, all right? The mentor must have a teachable spirit. These hardy, lift up people don't need to be sitting in your seat. Absorbing the wisdom of the mentor. The mentor must be careful to withhold assistance when it is in the best interest of the mentoree. The role as mentor is to encourage, is to admonish, and to reprove. Man, come on. Again, 2 Timothy 3:16 provides the biblical context of reproof, citing that all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the servant of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. All right? So that's the counseling. Bishop Carlos Moody, my pastor, counseled me when I was married. And sometimes the best counseling comes not from the counselor, but from someone else who can counsel you. You're like, what are you talking about now? All right, let me fix my mouth to say it this way. Bishop Carlos Moody is my pastor. Been my pastor since 1998, I think it was. All right? I got married. The marriage didn't last, but while I was married, we were going through problems. Now, prior to me getting married, though, Bishop Carlos Moody knows me. He knows Sir Walter. He knows my character. He knows my spirit. He knows the stuff I got myself in, and he got me out of it. Mm-hmm. I sat in the hot seat a few times, sat in his office a few times. Okay, young man, I'm going to help you out. I got married and started having problems in my marriage. Okay, so here's what Bishop Carlos Moody did in all his wisdom. He says, I'm not going to counsel y'all. I said, who? Nope, not going to do it. He said, this is why you got to know your calling. He said, sometimes some of my members, because, you know, Bishop Moody been a pastor since he was a teenager, so he kind of been in this thing a little while, just a little while, all right? Okay. So he said, sometimes my members, they know me, and so because I've kind of raised them, I remember them when they were born, and now they in their 30s sometimes, okay? He says, some of them can't really receive the counseling from me. I think the word bias jumped out the pages. I can't remember. All right? He says, so because you have this relationship with someone, after a while, you just can't tell them nothing because they just assume, well, in his eyes, I'm so-and-so. So he says, here's what I'm going to do for you and your wife. I'm going to send you over to this man that we know. He's a professional. He's a family counselor. He got degrees on the wall, all right? Yeah, yeah. He ain't even black. He downtown Chicago. I'm going to give you his number. He going to counsel you. Because I took you so far. Now I'm going to take you further by giving, see, because your problem, he can help you better. You see, a good leader is the one to tell you, I'm going to take you here, but I can only take you so far because that might be above my pay grade. That might be above my anointing. So I'm going to give you somebody. You see, a good shepherd is a person who not only feeds you, but a good shepherd is a person who makes sure you're fed, even if he ain't the one in the kitchen popping open them cans and them greens. He may not be the one. He may send you to somebody else's kitchen, but you still got fed, didn't you? And he going to get credit for it because he sent you to that kitchen. Am I right? Mm-hmm. So he sent me to a counselor who helped us in areas that my pastor says, I can't help you in that area. I'm not trained that way. And plus, you and I have a relationship where you may not be listening to me. And you know what? The man was right. Lord have mercy. Okay, so the season of contact, the season of coaching, the season of counseling, and here comes the season of companionship. Companionship, all right? The season of counseling eventually fades into the season of companionship. This transition dissolves the boundaries of the relationship and turns into more of a friendship. I am a friend of God. Okay? In this season, the mentee is free to disclose personal victories and failures, strengths and weaknesses, joys and disappointments that would not have been appropriate or feasible at any other time during the mentoring process. You see, there's some things I can't go through with DJ. He ain't ready yet. Okay? There's some things that I couldn't see. My pastor took me so far, but we were not really compassionately connected just yet. It took a while. When my pastor in South Dakota, once we got on a relationship where he took me through the contact process, he began to train and teach me, okay, how to become an effective minister. And then he realized this man has an anointing, so he ordained me as an elder, okay? He began to counsel me when I was having my issues, but then he went from being my bishop to my pastor to my father. So I began to call him father or dad. So the companionship kicked in. So he would have me come over to the house, and we'd be in the kitchen just cooking and have a great time, all right? And talking about life, and then going, he had a garden, and we would walk through the garden. I come to the garden alone. Well, I wasn't alone. I was with him, and we'd walk through the garden. We'd walk through the park. My pastor would take me even to the movie theater, and we'd sit down and watch some movies, okay, with popcorn. Me and my pastor, we had that companionship, and we talked about any and everything, like David and Jonathan. That's who he became to me. You see, a few years prior to that, I would have felt out of place doing that, and he would have felt out of place too. Who was this guy? Okay, in my kitchen. But then it became that companionship kicked in. Come on, y'all, the relationship has grown. Ooh, the actress, that's what I'm talking about. And then comes the season of continuance. The season of continuance. In this final season, the mentoree emerges. See, y'all got to understand, Jesus picked his 12. There were more disciples than the 12. The Bible says there were many disciples. But then Jesus said something. Ooh, I just had a pain in my side. Lord have mercy, somebody trying to attack my body. Jesus had some disciples. And when he says, eat of my body and drink of my blood, they said, this man is crazy. And the Bible says that these men walked away from him. They were called disciples, and they never returned. So Jesus was faced with, okay, who's with me? And he had a circle of men that followed him, those disciples. He picked 12. But watch this. He had three sets. He had the 12, and then he had the three. And those three he took further than the others. Those were the ones who met him on the Mount of Transfiguration. Y'all remember that story? And those are the ones who saw Moses come down, you know, all right? And they wanted to build an altar for him. Those are the ones where God, they heard God speak and said, this is my child, who I'm well pleased. Okay, those three right there, okay, Peter, James, and John were the ones. They were the triad of the gang. And those are the ones that, if you notice, the other ones, they kind of fell off. But as we go further into the New Testament, in the book of Acts, you notice that those three continued on in their ministry. Mm-mm-mm. So he had that set. And then he had a very compassionate man that he worked hard with, the one that he loved, old Peter. Mm-mm-mm. So he went through this process. He identified the 12, but then he mentored the three. Those three went through the gardens with him, okay? And then he took the one, because when he came from out of the grave, he said, go tell my disciples, and that one, Peter. See, because I got to show Peter something. I got to now show him more compassion than I do the other ones, because Peter, I can use him. There's something different about him. He hard-headed, hot-headed, and hard-headed. He want to kill everybody. But I got to work with him. See, because he denied me three times. But I'm going to make him reverse that. So Jesus says, do you love me, Peter? Yeah. I love you. Well, feed my sheep. Do you love me, Peter? You know I love you. Well, feed my lamb. Do you love me, Jesus? Peter? He said, ah! Then he realized, okay, three times. What was Christ doing? He was trying to get Peter to understand, I know you denied me thrice, but I'm about to fix this in your heart. Woo, Lord have mercy. I can't do this with y'all today. It's 10:30, and I'm teaching again on a Sunday night. All right? The season of continuous. All right? Continuance is here. In these final seasons, the mentor emerges ready to assume a more active role in ministry. Ah, but carefully, not to usurp the authority of the mentor or assume the role of successor prematurely. It ain't time yet. Just wait. The mentor usually moves into the background without totally abandoning the mentor and only offering support and advice when needed. Ooh, make it subtle. Just that subtle move. When the people are not supposed to skip a beat. They're not supposed to know when this big change happened. They're supposed to be like, come to church like, wow, I can't really tell the difference that much. Pastor ain't even around. But the anointing is still here. In his high acclaimed book, Transition Planning, Bob Russell makes an analogy of mentoring as a relay race. Mm-hmm. He addresses six key factors in the process. I ain't gonna tell you what that is because I want you to get the book. It's on Amazon.com. It's Elder Studemeyer. This book needs to be in your library. Succession, Mentoring the Next Generation by Joyce A. Graham. Rewind this video. It's gonna bless you. All right? Let me move further. Part one. Succession examples. She talks about Paul F. Crouch and Matthew Crouch. Y'all know that wonderful TV station, okay? Paul and Jan Crouch, Trinity Broadcast Network, started in 1973 with nothing more than a dream and a vision to build a Christian television station, okay? 5,000 television stations, 70 satellites, the internet, and thousands of cable systems around the world. Just amazing. But Paul got sick. And the older child was supposed to take the rings, but that didn't happen. It went to the baby. See, this story here reminds me of most of Abraham's children. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. They all went through that, even all the way back to Adam. Okay? That firstborn, although it's in the books that he's supposed to get the birthright, but that didn't always happen. It seemed to always go to the second boy, or maybe the third or the fourth boy, as it pertains to maybe Jacob. Jacob blessed his sons, and the first one, Reuben, missed out because he messed around with Jacob's handmaid, nasty dog. He messed around with his mama-in-law, okay? The Apostle Paul says, y'all doing things not even named among the Gentiles. You're sleeping with your father's wives. Nasty, all right? So Reuben missed out, and then who else was it? Simeon and Levi, the second and the third one, they missed out because they went killing everybody because that boy messed around with their sister. Okay? Dinah was kind of raped her, the dude. Y'all know the story. So these boys went and killed everybody in that territory. So those three missed out. So it went to the fourth child. Who was that? That boy right there was Judah. And y'all know who Judah is. Yeah, Judah. Praise. Okay? And we know who come from the line of Judah. He's a lion in the tribe. Oh, Lord, don't get me to start preaching. But y'all know the story of Jacob and Esau. Well, it didn't go to the oldest. It went to the second. All right. I'm trying to help y'all out. Paul Crouch had to make a decision. And he had to give that empire to Matthew. Get the book if you want to hear the story. Paul S. Martin and Joseph W. Walker III, another great story. Y'all know Paul. Open the floodgates of heaven, let it rain. All right? right? Paul Martin, Bishop, Senior Pastor of Changing a Generation Full Gospel Baptist. 1992, y'all remember the story? He formed the Full Gospel Baptist Church Fellowship International, FGBCFI. Mm-hmm. Yeah. He served for a long time, but he realized, I'm going to have to give this up. In walked Joseph W. Walker. The Lord told him before they went into a vote, because you got to do things democratically, God told Bishop Morton that that's the man for the job. Now, I'm going to let them vote. But God is going to turn their votes to the right way. All right? I met Joseph. Joseph W. Walker preached for us at the Holy Convocation in November in St. Louis and blessed my socks off till I did a show here called God's Strategy. What's God's strategy in your life? When y'all get through with this video, y'all go to that show that in my videos on Facebook. God's strategy in your life. I did that November 2016. So you're like, where that video at? Well, you just type it. Just type it in the search. God's strategy for your life. Just type that in the search on Facebook and my video will pop up. And it was based off of Joseph W. Walker's sermon. When I heard him preach, I said, he is the right successor. All right, Miles Monroe and David Burroughs. Come on, y'all already know this story. Dr. Miles Monroe founded Bahama Faith Ministries International in the 1980s. He quickly rose to prominence as a charismatic speaker and influential religious leader among evangelical Christians around the world. Well, we all know that God took him home and his wife and several others. I think it was seven other people in that plane crash. In a video clip recorded shortly before the death, Monroe said, the greatest act of leadership is what happens in your absence. I read this. If everything you've done dies with you, you are a failure. True leadership is measured by what happens after you die. And the greatest act of true leaders is mentoring. And true leaders identify their successor, mentor them, and train them. Who are you mentoring to take your place? And this man's children is running the business because he was training them while he was yet alive. Y'all got to get the book to hear the story. John H. Osteen and Joel Osteen, that multi-million dollar church and ministry, 1959, Pastor Osteen founded that Lakewood church in an old rehabbed feed store in Houston, Texas. All right? Y'all know the story. Read the book. It's going to bless you. Frederick K. Price Sr. and Frederick K. Price Jr. Apostle Frederick K. Price Sr., founder of the Crenshaw Christian Center located in Los Angeles, California. Hey, let's say man. Yeah, that's how you talk. He has been married since 1953 to the former Betty Ruth Scott, and they are the proud parents of four babies. Frederick K. Price III, Frederick K. Price Jr., Cheryl Price, and Angela Evans. Uh-huh. All right, so Frederick K. Price III died tragically in 1962 after being struck by an automobile. Well, 22,000 members. You want to know the rest of the story? Get the book. It's on Amazon.com. I mean, just filled with just Lizzie Robinson and Lillian B. Coffey. If you Kojic, you know them names. All of the concepts of the succession and mentoring process apply to women as well as to men. And the fact of the matter is that women have served in key critical leadership roles in the church since its inception. Hassle never. Not much have been mentioned or written about the succession of mentoring roles of women in the church, although it occurs with great, great frequency, by the way. In the Church of God in Christ, the denomination of which I am a member, the first documented succession involving women occurred between the two servants of God, Mother Lizzie Robinson and Mother Lillian B. Coffey. Woo! Come on, women, say amen, Joyce. Yep, great succession. Mother Lily Robinson was the first woman to organize the women's work in Coventry. A wonderful woman of God. Mother Robinson was a matron of the Baptist Academy in Durham, Arkansas. Observing her organizational strengths, Bishop Charles H. Mason appointed her as overseer of the women in 1911. And she was responsible for forming the prayer and Bible band. Y'all have heard that name, right? Well, this is the woman who's responsible for that. Y'all heard of the sewing circle? When I was young, I just thought it was a bunch of old cackling women around sitting around with some rocking chairs sewing up stuff, you know, for pastor. That's what I thought the sewing circle was when I was young. Mm-hmm. And the home and foreign mission, okay? Home foreign mission. My pastor, Bishop Carlos Moody, served as the president of home and foreign mission until he resigned last year, okay? He had been serving since 1975, I think it is. Longest serving man, okay? At least one of the longest serving in the Church of God in Christ, my pastor. Well, that home and foreign mission set up by who? Not a man, but a woman. Them missionaries mostly were women. They were the bold and the beautiful, all right? They went out there and they was winning, folks. And the churches were growing because of the women were going out there doing the work, street corners, going into the shelters, okay, and building shelters, right? They were the ones going to the homes, the women. So why is it that when you go to the average church, there is 85% women and there's just a few men, but the men are the ones in control of everything? Them the ones that sit in the pulpit? I just don't understand why they're the only ones sitting in the pulpit, but the women are the ones who built that church with their hard-earned money, so in circle. All right. Yeah. All right. If you want to hear the rest of the story, get the book, y'all. Oh. All right. Now watch this. I'll tell y'all in a minute. Robert H. Schuller and Robert A. Schuller. That big cathedral, y'all. I'm about to do a show called The End of White Christian America. I'm about to do a book review on this one. The End of White Christian America by Robert P. Jones. Ooh, it's another book that's going to bless you. Y'all got to get this book right here, okay? You want to know about white folks? White evangelicals? This is the Bible for that. And he mentioned Robert Schuller in that Crystal Cathedral. It got put in somebody else's hand, but prior to that, all right? Biblical successions. Now, these are people we know. Here's the people we never met. Moses and Joshua. Lord have mercy. Moses and Joshua. Y'all know Moses' story. Y'all know God says, look out. You see that place right there? That place of milk and honey? You ain't going in there. Your people might go there. Well, some of them. But you can't go because you disobeyed me. But I'm going to bless you. And he did. Joshua came on the scene. God said, wake up, Joshua. I got to talk to you. Yes, yes. Well, my servant Moses is dead. You was around him mostly. You served up under him. Okay, you and Aaron. I sent Aaron, but Aaron is a priest. I'm not going to put him in that position. He's a priest. He's got to do other things. But you got to take the people a little further. That's the Joshua anointing, y'all. Woo! Numbers 27 and 15. And Moses spake unto the Lord, saying, let the Lord, the God of the spirits of all flesh, set a man over the congregation. He said it while he was alive, y'all. Mm-hmm. Which may go out before them, and which may go in before them, and which may lead them out, and which may bring them in, that the congregation of the Lord be not as sheep which have no shepherd. And the Lord said unto Moses, take thee Joshua, woo, the son of Nun. Joshua didn't have no parents, y'all, because he was the son of Nun. Okay. Oops. All right. He was the son of Nun. N-U-N, by the way. A man in whom is the Spirit. And lay thine hand upon him. Lay your hands on him like the Apostle Paul. I don't want to go ahead of myself. I mentioned Paul. That's coming up, y'all. Stay tuned. If you want to know the rest of the story, get the book She breaks it down in the way that the Bible doesn't break it down. She breaks it down in just clever ways, okay? Saul and David. Oh, Lord, Saul. That's Saul. King Saul, the one who went down there and supposed to did war and killed everybody, but he brought back the spoils of war. And the prophet said, are you crazy? What is wrong with you, Saul? Stop lying. Stop lying. Obedience is better than sacrifice. You see that king you captured? Bring him here. And killed that king. Says, how many times? Nine, because you did this. God is upset with you. You ain't going to live long. Mm-hmm. So Saul was only going to sit on that throne for just a while, all right? Because God was preparing a successor. He was preparing the successor while Saul was yet acting the fool. And then God put this, identified who the successor is, as she said earlier in the chapter, okay? You make an identity on who it is. Once Saul realized who it was, you see, and it didn't happen until those women start screaming, Saul killed his 1,000, but David killed his 10,000. And Saul was like, oh, no, oh, 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 stop the records. Stop the presses. You mean to tell me you going to praise and honor this man like that? And I'm your king? He ain't nothing but a little ruddy little boy back there tackling sheep, lions, and tigers, and bears, oh my. That guy right there. So God had to take the prophet Samuel and say, I need you to go in Jethro's house. Not Jethro Bodine. Go in Jethro's house and I need you to anoint a king. Because this king I got over here sitting on this throne, I got to do something with this one. Now, I put him there because y'all said y'all wanted a king. Because the other nations have him. So I'm giving y'all what you want, Donald Trump. Mm-hmm. I'm going to let him sit here for a few years, but I got to prepare another one. Go in that boy's house. And Sammy went in there and said, oh, look at this tall, beautiful guy right here. He must be the one. And he took the oil. He said, yeah, I'm about to bless you. Bow your head. Oh, Lord. Play metachristianly, please. Hammond B3, turn it up. Ah, yeah, Lord, bow your head, lift your hands. God wants to anoint you king, and God stopped him. He said, he ain't the one. He said, don't look upon their face. That's because he's handsome and goodly. Mm-mm, he ain't the one. Don't get caught up in the outward appearance, because I look on the heart. Whoa, Lord, he says, okay, well, maybe the next one is the one. Okay, bow your heads, lift your hands. Hammond B, turn it up. Let me anoint you guys. And nope, he ain't the one either. He went down to all those boys, and he's like, ain't nobody else in this house, God. And God says, go outside in the back. King David, and the oil poured, woo, on that man's head. Lord have mercy, poured on David, and his beard was all wet. Man, he had to go down there and get him. Okay, beard all wet up, and says, you now king. But watch this though. Samuel anointed this boy king, even though there was already a king sitting on the throne. David couldn't even sit on the throne yet. It took him a long time, even though he was anointed to do the job. Man, you got to read the book. These pastors who are anointing either their sons or their sons in the gospel as pastor while they're still pastor is a smart move. He's senior pastor, and he's pastor. My pastor, Carlos Moody Sr., is the senior pastor. His son is the assistant pastor. All right? Smart move. Paul did a smart move. Martin did a smart move. Clay Evans, here in Chicago, did a smart move while he was yet breathing. He said, I've got to get somebody else to sit in the ship and take this ship to the next generation. Okay? I won't be back. I'm going to be back. That man. No more. No. Yes. Uh-huh. And he selected not an old dude. He didn't select nobody his age. He selected somebody young. And put him in that chair and said, you the pastor now. I'm going to go retire. Come on. Y'all don't understand. This is happening all over the country now. People are wising up. She is a great woman of God. Please get her book, Evangelist Joyce. All right now, Dottie Ledbetter. Y'all know each other? very wise and anointed woman, proud to know her personally. I doubt it. You ain't tell me that this woman was this anointed. I ain't know. Okay? I ain't know. Great book review, Sir Joyce. I am ordering a book for me and one for a young woman that mentors teenage girls. The actress, thank you, girl. Let's get these books out there to the masses. All right? Saul and David. If you want to know more about that story, go buy the book. David and Solomon. David had to tell Solomon through God. Solomon, don't mess up. Don't screw this up. Don't screw this up. Please, whatever you do. I'm in chapter 12. Chapter 12. Look at that. Page 100. Now, that says page 001. There's no such thing as 001. But look at that. I'm at page 100. You see how fast we got through this book? And it is 1 hour and 15 minutes. And we done went through 100 pages. That's how fast you can read this book, people. I ain't got but a couple pages left. You can read this book in one night and be poured into with wisdom. David and Solomon, that's chapter 12. I'm telling y'all, and I know I'm giving the highlights, but these chapters are like 2-3 pages. That's it. I love it. Now, this book here is going to take me a little while. And I got a book that's even thicker. Wait a minute, I'm going to show y'all this book here. I'll show y'all this book. This book here is called America's Unwritten Constitution. It's a great book. Look how thick that sucker is, though. It's taken me 6 months to go through this book. But I'm using it as a textbook. It's a great, great writing. This is a... And you need to get this book in your library, Joyce, if you get a chance. America's Unwritten Constitution by Akhil Reed Amar. Okay? It's just a great history on the Constitution of the United States, unwritten. All right? You nerds out there. That's gonna do you good. Okay. All right. I'm always promoting people. I love promoting people. Don't y'all love promoting people? It's so nice to be nice. Yes, you can. It's an easy read. Sir Arthur is doing a great job of reviewing the book. High five, Joyce! Bam! High five, okay? All right. She says, I have lots of books. Amen. What? Yes, she said, I may already have it. Elijah and Elisha. Ooh! And them two right there should be the cornerstone of how everybody should work their predecessors and their successions or what have you. Elijah and Elisha. Y'all know what Elijah said. Elisha said, I want to be like you. I want to be like Mike. Want to be like Mike. And Elijah said, listen, if you're standing here at certain time, you're going to get a double portion. Oh, you're going to get it. You see, I could teach that message. You got to be in the place. You see, I know a pastor who died. And all of the elders were scrambling trying to see who's going to be the greatest in the kingdom. who's going to be the one that take on the pastoral role. But you see, they wasn't around when the pastor, you know, during Sunday school, they weren't around. During homeform mission, they weren't around. During Bible study, nope. Okay, during night service, nope. When the pastor went, nope, they weren't around, all right? There was only a couple of people who were around. They saw the pastor go through and come out and then go through again and come out. They washed his feet and they carried his briefcase. They put his robe on. They went to the hospital when he was ill. They went out. They did things with him because they was with him. So when he got sick, when it was time for him to die, then some of these men started showing up more and more, and the people didn't know who these men were. Even though they had been in the ministry a long time in that same church, they didn't know who they were, if you know what I mean. So now you want to be pastor when all these years, when we were here, you were not, okay? No, these other men who work side by side, we're going to take them through the process, but y'all can go home. Elijah and Elisha, yeah, and it came to pass when they were gone over that Elijah said unto Elisha, Ask what I shall do for thee before I be taken away from thee. And Elisha said, I pray thee, let a double portion of thy spirit be upon me. That's 2 Kings 2:9. Mm-hmm. And when the sons of the prophets which were to view at Jericho saw him, they said, the spirit of Elijah thus rest in Elisha. 2 Kings 2:15. You see what I'm saying? From the time 2 Kings 2:19 to just a few verses later, the spirit of Elijah hit that man. Oh, I'm wrapping this up, y'all. I'm in chapter 14 already. Vashti and Esther, you ladies really like this story. And the king loved Esther above all the women, and she obtained grace and favor in his sight more than all the virgins, so that he set the royal crown upon her head and made her queen instead of Vashti. That's 2:17. Mm-mm-mm. Y'all, that story has a nice twist on it. Chapter 15, Jesus and the disciples. I already gave y'all that one. I ain't even got to go through that one because that one right there blessed my socks off. All right, chapter 16, Paul and Timothy. Mm-hmm. Paul laid hands on this boy. For I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. 2 Timothy 4:6. But continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of knowing of whom thou hast learned. 2 Timothy 3:14. Preach the word. Be instant in season, out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. That's 2 Timothy 4:2. Man, what a contemporary of Paul. Timothy and Titus and several others. Even Apollos, who was a mighty man, okay, in scripture. And he introduced them to Aquila and Priscilla. And so that they can show him a more perfect way in the Lord. So Paul became a father to many. He says, although you may have many instructors, you don't have many teachers, many fathers, that is. He said, I'll be a father to you. Mm-hmm. And so Paul began to go out there and capture these young men and these women and help them on their mission, his missionary journeys. All right? Timothy was not circumcised. Okay? Yeah. Last chapter. Joyce, I'm at the last chapter. Timothy was not circumcised. And he hated, but because, see, Timothy's father was a Roman or a Greek, but his mother, Eunice and Enos, I think it was, okay, they were Jewish women, and so the people in the temple wouldn't receive Timothy. So what did the successor, what did the predecessor do? Paul, he said, I'm coming, boy, I'm gonna get you El Circumciso, because these people ain't listening to you, and the Jews require signs, and they need to see the signs. Okay, and once you raise your skirt, they'll see, oh, you one of us? Well, come on in. So Paul said, I'll be all things to all men so that I might win some. Hello there. Yeah, Paul, he squall. He tuned up. And Paul and Timothy is a great example of succession and predecessor. Y'all, that was the last chapter. And in walks the epilogue. I took y'all through the whole book. I did that. I enjoyed doing that. This is a blessing. Please let me know if you got when you get this book. Succession, Mentoring the Next Generation. Joyce A. Graham. You pastors out there, you bishops and apostles, this needs to be on your bookshelf. And it needs to be in your office at the church, and a copy should be at the house so that you can have easy access to it. Grab it. And if there's somebody in your church who's watching you, and you know they're watching you because you identified with it, all right, then grab the book and says, oh, man, they're watching me. Let me see. Now, I know Elder Jones was talking about this woman with the unisexual name. What was her name? I can't remember what her name, but Elder Jones was talking about it in that book. Oh, Pat. Yeah, that's her Pat. That's the name. Pat Enos was mentioning something about the season of mentoring. Now, the season of contact. I see that person watching me. Now, what do I do next? Grab the book. identified. Okay, I got that. Now I gotta start teaching that person. We'll go through a coaching season, and then go through a counseling season, and then go through a companionship season, and then go through a continuance season. It's right in the book. I lie not. Okay? It's gonna bless you. Make that a part of your book collection, okay? And we'll be going through. I would love to do this book next, okay? This white Christian thing. Yeah, I would love to do that. So if you have a book, those of you who, Barbara, are you still with me? You gone? You went to eat? You on a Daniel fast? You got some chicken in your hand? What you got? Where you at? Okay, because I'm waiting on your book. I'm waiting. If you have a book that you want me to review on live, I will do it. This video is going on YouTube. So those of you who are on YouTube, go ahead and hit the subscribe button if you can. And go ahead and share this. Those of you on Facebook, hit the share button. I would like that, please. Thank you. I'm going to put this in some of the groups. And some of you, don't just put it on the wall, but put it in groups that you're part of, Facebook groups. I'm not talking about putting it in a cooking show on Facebook. If you're in a cooking group, no, it don't belong there. Don't break the rules. Put it in a group where you know it's ministry, where you know that people will be benefit from it. Because they'll see me and say, oh, that Walter got his videos in crazy places. Because y'all put it there. Okay. So be a blessing to Joyce A. Graham and her wonderful family. And she's got a testimony, all right? She talked about her child here today and gone tomorrow. Well, today. Here today, then gone today. Hear her testimony. Hear how she's coming back and went back out there to launch her counseling. I'm telling you, you just need to hear some people. You don't know what people go through until you hear their stories and their testimonies. Ooh, it's going to bless you. That's going to tear you up a little bit. So make sure you get a box of tissue and sit down and talk with Joyce. And she's going to bless you, okay? Get the book. It's going to bless you. Amen. She said, yes, I'm back. And you were so instrumental in my recovery. Wow. That just went right to the marrow in my bone. I felt that in my heart. It's in my heart, this melody of love divine. God, we thank you for your presence and your blessings. We thank you for all you've done for us in this broadcast here. The people of God seem to have been blessed by the words that came out of this book. Continue to anoint my dear sister Joyce. Continue to give her the insight. Continue to pour into her visions and dreams. And give her experiences in life so that she could help us. As she continued to write, as she authored these stories, God, the people who not even born yet will read her stuff, read her materials, read what you've given her, and they'll be able to build up and raise up other successors in ministry. Help her, God. Anoint her ever the more, and her husband, God. We thank you for it. And we give your name the praise and the glory shall be yours in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Felicia Harmon Brown, thank you so much for making my event even more special by showing them. Hey, Felicia. Felicia, you know I had to be there. Felicia Harmon Brown, I have this wonderful ministry of mime. And when she puts on an event, the people pack the place out. She's got an amazing following. And I just love it. And I, again, when y'all see these people come on my wall and say thank you, I don't ask them to do that, you know. I don't pay them to do that. I show up to events uninvited. I just show up and I can sit in the balcony. I really don't care. I know people like to put me up in the front, you know, but I really don't have to. You can put me in the basement and put a speaker so that I can hear what's going on. I really don't have to be noticed, but these people say thank you because I believe in supporting the people of God. I believe wholeheartedly because when I was coming up, I really didn't have too many mentors to help me. I was out there by myself being a middle child, okay? I did a show called The Birth Order. I know it's all about books with me, y'all. I'm a bookworm. The Birth Order. Tell me you got this one, Joyce. Kevin Lehman, The Birth Order Book. That one right there. If you want to know about your family, where you fit. Right there. I met this man, sat at the table with him. He autographed a copy, and he looked at me and said, "You're the middle child." I said, "Are you a prophet?" That man right there, Kevin Lehman. Get that book. Why don't we do a review on this one soon, okay? So I support people because me being the guy seemed like I'm left out. I was looking for love in all the wrong places. I'm looking for people to help me. And then these guys said, "Show me these chords." Show me. They were like, "We ain't got time, little boy. Shoe fly, don't bother me." And I remember sitting in the sandbox. Sitting in the sandbox with my little my toy car. I'm playing in the sandbox by myself. Pew, pew, pew. And I remember stopping, and I started crying in the sandbox. You know why I was crying? Because nobody would play with me. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, and my mother was on the back porch with her Coca-Cola bottle. Pepsi Cola. She liked Pepsi Cola, and she'd sit there, and we had a little TV on the back. It was portable, and she was watching her soap operas, As the World Turns, and all my cheering and stuff, okay? And I go and lay in her lap. So, son, nobody want to play with me. And I know my mother felt that. See, my older brothers, they were out chasing girls. I was a nerd. And my younger siblings weren't even born yet. Okay? I might have had one, maybe two born. See, there's five up under me. There's three above me. And then I was a baby for almost 5 years. So I'm the only one other than my baby sister who know how it feels to be the baby in the family. So I was a baby for 5 years. And as I'm growing, I have nobody up under me. You see what I'm saying? To play with. So for 5 years, I'm just nobody. So I would walk up and down the street. I would, finally, when my mother bought me a bicycle, I would take my bicycle and then ride it all the way downtown Chicago. I lived on the west side. For those of you who know anything about Chicago, from the west side to downtown on a bicycle, it's going to take you almost an hour. And I did that all the time. I just rode my bike downtown by the lakefront. I didn't want to be around family or nobody. If anybody's going to love me, God going to love me. And I would go by the lakefront and talk to the Lord. And then it was there where I met. I learned the voice of God. And he kept reminding me, "You are not alone. You are not alone. You are not alone. You are not alone." Ooh, I'm about to tear up right now. "You are not alone." I didn't know he was preparing me. I didn't know. So I would come back and just excited, and he began to put music in me. And then he began to show me how to pick out chords on the piano. Okay? He would bring in mentors like Elder Dennis Griffin comes by here every now and then, and Pastor Kenneth Wright would sit down with me every now and then and show me a few chords, and then they can only take me so far. And then the Lord began to give me insight on how to, you know, strategize the chord structure. Then he began to pour songs in me. And I wrote my first song in 1983. Of course, what was my first song called? "When I'm Alone." Then I began to write alone songs. But the end of the story always had me to come out of loneliness. Because the Lord gave me these visions. All right? And as I got older, I began to try to set up under people who had influence, right? But I was shy. I didn't know how to do that. So I was only be around them for a few minutes, then I was out of there because I didn't know how to bond with people. I didn't trust everybody. I just didn't do it, you know? So as I got older, I realized how important people are to people. People, people who need people. All the luckiest people. Barbara Streisand. Ooh, love me some Barbara Streisand. Okay. Babs. Is that her name? Okay. With the nose. That song right there was just blessing me. People who love people. People who need people. Are the luckiest people in the world. I began to understand how important it is. No man is an island. So I began to interact with people more and more. And then I formed a gifted ensemble, a singing group. And then people from all over start joining my singing group. And then I was reminded that your name is Walter, and it means leader. You can't be a leader and you sit in the sandbox crying. Nobody want to play with me. You're going to make it happen. You go out there and get friends. You go out there and get associates. You go out there and help other people, and I'm going to help, and I'm going to bless you. And so I did. I put a little ad in these little sections of the paper, and people from all over the place start coming to my rehearsals. And I start getting these opportunities, and the mayor's office start calling me to do these events, and the Alzheimer's and the cancer groups, and they started having me to come and sing, and I'd write songs, and before you knew it, in walked the Sir Walter Jones Show. Okay, now that took a while to build. So what do? I pop up at all y'all's events. If I see it on Facebook or somewhere, I'm popping up. I'm showing up. They're like, oh, Sir Walter's here. Oh, my. And I dig in my pocket. I give my offering, okay? And I promote you on social media and go home and rest well. And forget I did it. And then the people come back and say, thank you. And I thank you for what? I did that? I got men... From when they were teenagers. They up in age right now. They're traveling around the world, and sometimes they'll walk into a convention and say, that's the man right there. Okay? They plan for all of the big-time gospel artists, and they'll say, that's my piano teacher. That's the man who gave me my first chord. That's the man who taught me this. That's the man who taught my choir, and I was sitting in the back. I wasn't old enough to sing in the choir, but he was doing a music seminar, and I was taking notes. And now he's traveling around with Marvin Sapp and the Whiners and all these people. Okay, and I'm sitting to myself, I did that? You was that little boy back there in the back when Mama was like, sit down, little boy. You were the one? Yes. I remember all your words. I thank God for that. He has blessed our ministry. And so, in return, I have to bless the people. All right, that's my story, and I'm sticking to it. That is my story. All right, we got a lot of books to cover, and I'm going to get out of here. I've been on here long enough. All right, y'all. Love you guys. Hit the share button. It's too late to do an evening manner. Maybe, shoot. I promised somebody I would do the evening manner. Rochelle, I put music to your song. I don't even remember that. I'll come back and do even. I don't want to mix these two together. So let's cut this. I'll come back, do an evening manner. All right? But I want Joyce. This is her time. I don't want to mix the manners with Joyce's. So this is about Joyce A. Graham. All right? And then I'll do a manner in a couple minutes. All right? How about that? All right, love you, Joyce. Thank you for the material. Thank you for the book. You blessed me, and you're going to bless so many others. All right. Love you guys. Peace to you. See you in a few minutes. And give me a song. I need a song for Evening Manor. Put it in the comments. All right. Bye.